Much. And my name is Gino Wong, and I come from University of Nantes. And I'm glad to be successful to give a presentation finally. And I'm here to present you our work. The paper is a study about quantifying how the combination of blur and disparity can affect the perceived depth in a stereoscopy images. And as we know, there are several depth tools that enable us to perceive depth. Some of them work using only one eye, while others work only when we use both of our eyes. However, the 3D TV nowadays enhance only one tool, the binocular disparity. Considering the viewing distance, this method can be effective, but it also introduces some problems. Because almost all the displays nowadays are with a planar screen, the use of disparity causes a conflict between accommodation and vergence. This conflict could be limited by reducing the disparity of the content, but the perceived depth decreases at the same time. That means we lose some perceived depth. So we have a question, can we reduce the disparity? Meanwhile, we enhance another depth cue to compensate this loss and keep the same perceived depth. In our paper, we decide to use blur to have a try. There are two reasons why we choose blur to study. The first reason is that blur is a monocular depth cue, so it doesn't increase any conflict. The second reason is that blur have been shown to be quite effective in 2D images when we need to use it to change the object's perceived depth, the apparent distance, the apparent size, and something like that. And we found that some work had been done by George Mather before. They also tried to prove some increase of object's perceived depth by blurring the background of stereoscopic stimuli. They use a 70-inch CRT monitor working at 96 frame rate to display some random dot stereogram. The method they applied for the experiment was pair comparison. They asked the observer to identify the depth difference in the stereogram with and without blur. But the pity is that the results show the blur could make only marginal difference to perceived depth, about only 40 arc seconds. This work was done several years ago, and I think during this period, the evolution of stereoscopic display technology is quite great. Now, maybe it's not a bad idea to check again with the improved hardware and better selected stimuli to check if we can guess a new result or different result. Therefore, we conducted a subjective experiment by using a state-of-the-art stereoscopic display system. We used a 22-inch Samsung LCD monitor, which works at 120 Hz frame rate. I think the performance of the LCD monitor might be considerably different from the CRT monitor used before in several ways. First, the surface of a CRT screen is slightly curved, and because the front plate of the screen is glass, the virtual distance of the stimuli might be affected a little by the refraction. Secondly, a 17-inch display working at 114 centimeters, the viewing distance might generate the field of view, which is not that large enough. Too many things could be perceived by the observer's eyes in the peripheral fovea. And another reason is that the speed of the photosphere changes in the CRT display might also cause some crosstalk. Besides the display, there are also some other changes in our experiment setup. First, we use the stimuli which are closer to natural content. compared to the random oscillogram used in the previous research. I will introduce it in the following pages. Another difference is that we measure the effect of blur, which is at different depth and different relative distance between the known object and the blur object. Now, here's the setup of our experiment. The display part has been already introduced. About the 3D system, we use the NVIDIA 3D vision kit. Observer look at the screen through the pair of active shuttle glasses at a distance of 90 centimeters, more or less three times of the height of the screen. And about the subject part, there are totally 35 subjects that took part in the experiment. They didn't know the purpose of the experiment. And in order to make sure that they are appropriate for our tests, we did some pretests to validate their visual acuity, depth acuity, and color vision. And in our experiment, we used pair comparison to get the psychophysical function, then find the point of subjective equality. Two 3D images were shown to the observer each time. One image is with a blurred background, while the other one is with a sharp background. We use a 2D flower bed photo as the background and the butterfly as the foreground object. The depth of both foreground and background is decided by disparity. In the first kind of stimuli, we blur the background by a Gaussian filter to simulate the defocus blur. Therefore, the depth cue in this kind of stimuli contains not only disparity, but also blur. For the second kind of stimuli, we use disparity in exactly the same way to create depth. But the difference is that the background image will not blur out. So in this stimuli, disparity is the only depth cue can be used by the observer to perceive depth. One thing I want to mention is that in our experiment, both the absolute depth of the background and the relative distance between the background and the foreground stay as three parameters, so that we can measure the effect of blur according to different absolute depth of the or the different relative distance between the two planes. Now, by having two kinds of stimuli, we can start the pair comparison. Observer will ask to compare each blur background stimulus to several sharp background stimulus. We measure the proportion of response that choose the blur background stimuli as the one with larger relative distance between the foreground and the background. Then we can feed a psychometric function, then get 50% point, which we consider it as the point of subjective equality. Now it's the result and analysis. In our work, we consider the result obtained from all the absolute depth of background and all the possible relative distance. First, we try to compute the effect of blur at different absolute depth of blur background. Here is the result. And in this figure, the x-axis is the depth of the background. And the y-axis shows how much disparity can be compensated by the blur. So we can consider this value as the increase of perceived depth. And as we can see, the increase of perceived depth is approximately equal to 300 arc seconds. Actually, this value is quite large compared to the result of 40 arc seconds obtained before by other papers. Our results show that blur can increase the perceived depth quite obviously. Another thing that we can find from this figure is that no matter at which depth plane we add some blur, the contribution of blur to the perceived depth is more or less the same. And in this figure, it shows how the increase of perceived depth varies according to the relative distance between foreground and background. We can find that even with the same level of blur, if the blur is added at the depth plane, which is further away from the foreground, the blur can compensate more disparity. That means the effect of blur increases with the relative distance between the foreground and the background. For example, as we can see this point and this point, if we add blur at the depth plane 23 centimeters behind the object, it's this point, we can decrease 400 arc seconds disparity of this object while keep the same perceived depth of that object. But if we add blur at a depth plane 28 centimeters behind the object, we can decrease 600 arc seconds disparity of this object while keep the same perceived depth. And considering the resulting of experiment, we find that the blur can increase the perceived depth more than what people found before. I think this might be caused by two factors. The first factor is the display. The technology of stereoscopic display have changed tremendously these years. The displays nowadays can already, The display nowadays can already provide much more precise image information so that the effect of blur might benefit from it. The second factor is the content we choose. Because blur is a natural phenomenon that people can perceive every day, so introducing blur into a natural image might create more influence than introducing blur in some synthesis content. Another thing I want to discuss is about the quality of experience. So do we really increase the quality of experience by adding some blur? Remind that one purpose of our research is trying to increase the QoE of 3D TV. However, we know many factors that actually affect the QoE. Exactly about the number of the factor is still an open question, and maybe viewing geometry, maybe crosstalk, maybe distortion, and something like that. Besides, what's the weight of each of these factors is still an open question. Nevertheless, I think it would be reasonable for us to consider that the QoE of 3D TV might contain at least three dimensions. These three dimensions, the visual comfort, the depth perception, and the visual quality. And based on the processing of 3D images proposed in our research, we can decrease the binocular disparity to reduce the conflict between accommodation and vergence. So the visual comfort can be increased. On the other hand, we introduce blur to compensate the loss of perceived depth, so the depth perception can be kept. Now we have a question, did we change the visual quality? Because we apply blur on the image, the content of the image has actually been changed. But to me, whether the visual quality is affected depends on whether the blur part contains the region of interest. If the region of interest is kept sharp, maybe the visual quality is only affected very little. But if the blur part contains any regions of interest, important information of the scene is lost. That will definitely affect the visual quality. One last thing necessary to be taken care is that whether the processing of the image will change the position of region of interest, creating new region of interest, because there is a strong relationship between the blur and the visual attention. And at last, I want to say that there are still many issues according to our approach at the QOE, which is necessary to be verified in the future. And that's what we are going to do in our future work. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Question, yeah, Martin?
Hello. That's a nice result. You got a bigger effect of blur with increasing distance. But you said something I'm going to disagree with. You said that changing blur does not create a conflict with disparity, and I'm going to disagree with that. And the reason I disagree is that disparity is a depth cue based on triangulation, right? Two eyes different.
Yeah.
And blur is the same. Blur is a triangulation depth cue based on light entering the pupil in different positions.
Yes.
And so the relationship between blur and disparity is basically always constant in human vision.
Yes.
So when you change that relationship, you did introduce a conflict.
Right. Thank you.
Right here.
I guess a fundamental question is, do you also compare 2D image with blur and to see if there's additional increased depth judgment because of it, which would be a good way to see if it's just due to cognitive interpretation or it's due to any interaction between disparity and blurred presentation?
This is well known to be the case, I believe. Go ahead.
And actually?
Yeah, it does.
Actually, in this figure, the first point is that the foreground object and the background object, there are no disparity difference between the foreground and the background. So that can be considered as the 2D situations. So we can see that there's still a little of increase in 2D situations.
I'm pretty sure this is kind of well known, even outside of that. If there's not, there was a paper that showed direct effect on this comfort just by adding the blur, which had no really argument why it affected the discomfort, but showed that images with the blur in the background are less annoying or less discomfort causing. The problem is how one would work that into an actual content is a difficult problem. I always say that if a movie director can't decide where you're going to look, they should look for another occupation. But despite that being a nice statement and maybe right, we are free to look around, and in some of the movies that we saw that there's freedom to look. So the depth in a natural environment, except in very large distances scenes, the depth has to do with where your focusing is. So it is somewhat tricky, not maybe impossible, or at least requiring eye movement tracking, which some people suggested, to affect it. So for just the movie kind of media or game, this may not be so simple to implement. Not a reason to stop it, but I think it's yes, there's a question there. Or?
There was just one thing that concerned me in your image data, which was there was another monocular depth cue in your background image, which was a scale change. So you've got very much a set of flowers that are large in the foreground, smaller in the background, and a tapering off. Do you think that affected your result at all and gave an extra perception of depth that might not have been there otherwise if you'd had a flat image?
Sorry, can you repeat your questions?
Do you think the fact that you had a scale change, depth Q,
yeah,
in your background image had an impact on your result? As in, do you think that would have given contributed to the user's perception of greater depth?
Actually, when we choose the image for the background, we try to include as few depth cues as possible. So I know you talked about the size of the background and the foreground object.
The texture
path. Okay, I think.
Yeah, once you put it back up, can you go back quickly to the image? Just get out of it with escape. And then, okay, there we go. So, there is some. It's not very strong, but I think there is some. Yeah. Another question there. Behind you. Thank you.
I was wondering if you were to try the same sort of thing with a video sequence where you have additional depth cues like moving occlusion boundaries and things like that. Do you think the change in perceived depth with blur would be similar to this experiment or different?
You mean in the video?
Yeah, with video, because you have additional depth cues. Occlusion boundaries, you can separate foreground, background, because of the boundaries that move.
Actually, I'm not quite sure about that. Sorry.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
It's a good question. Combination of cues, but I think I don't see a lot. Oh, one more question here. We'll take that. Since we made it on time, I think it's... Yeah, really amazing. See the ring.
So interesting work. I just have a comment about it. One thing I like to do when I look at 3D is explore the space. So it would bother me to have things that are blurred. But there may be another way, though. At the Consumer Electronics Show, Samsung introduced a new feature in their 3D TV where they used Eric perspective, or, you know, where things further away are grayer. Yeah. They accentuated that, kept the images sharp, but did some kind of image processing so things further away were grayer than they would normally be, as another depth cue. So I guess my question for you is maybe you might want to investigate that as another approach which would avoid blur, but still provide another cue other than disparity.
Thank you.
Okay, I guess this was a comment. So thank you very much. Before we disassemble, Andrew, wanted to make an announcement or say something else?
Well, thank you very much, Fairley, for chairing this session as part of the joint effort between the SD&A conference and HVEI.